welcome to another episode of He's Not Done Yet. We are so delighted that you've tuned in today. And, you know, He's Not Done Yet is a radio ministry that goes out on Victory Radio at 100.9, 95.3, and 1530 AM. It airs on Sunday morning. And then we are also on Faith Talk at 99.5, and it airs on Tuesday evening at 6 p.m., and then they replay again on Sunday morning at 8 a.m. We'd love to invite you to the First Pentecostal Church. We have church on Sunday morning, and we also have church on Sunday night, but Sunday morning's at 10:30. We're back at 7 p.m. on Sunday night. Now, if y'all are down to just one service on Sunday, we'd love to invite you to come on Sunday night, as well as we'd love for you to come on our midweek service on Tuesday at 7 p.m. And we'd be delighted that you would come. And we also would like for you to, you know, you could reach out to us on he'snotdoneyet.com, he'snotdoneyet.com. Feel free to give me a call or text at 501-339-8017, 339-8017. Today's scripture comes from Lamentations, and it's going to be 3, 22, and 23. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because His compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is Thy faithfulness. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Lord, I love You. I praise You today, God. I honor You, Lord. I thank You for being here, God, and we just love You so much, Lord, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on, you ought to put your hands together. Come on, there's a blessing in the room. I won't have room to receive it, Lord. It's gonna overflow.
Overflow.
Come on, sing it.
Overflow.
Said, I'm getting ready.
I'm getting ready for my overflow.
Cause God is
opening up the window. Pour me out a blessing.
I won't have room.
Receive it, Lord. Overflow.
Overflow.
Overflow. I'm getting ready for my
preparing a net, breaking, boat sinking, miracle just for me. I won't have room to receive it, Lord. It's gonna overflow. Say overflow.
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 I'm getting ready.
I'm getting ready for my overflow.
Say God is
opening up the windows.
And He's pouring me out.
Oh, I won't have room to receive it, Lord. It's gonna overflow.
The days of defeat and lack for me. What's headed this way my eyes have never seen. God's preparing the net, breaking, boat sinking, miracle just for me. I won't have room to receive it, Lord. It's gonna overflow.
Raised up, defeated like a overflow.
What's headed this way?
What's headed this way my eyes have never seen.
Come on, God's preparing.
repairing, a net breaking, boat sinking, miracle just for me. I won't have room to receive it, Lord, it's gonna overflow. You say,
days of defeat and lack of
victory.
Victory.
I got the victory.
Victory.
I got the victory.
Victory.
Come on, you ought to praise
victory.
Him.
Victory. 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 Victory.
I got the victory.
Victory.
I got the victory.
Victory.
I got the victory.
Victory.
I got the victory.
Victory. Victory. Victory. Victory.
Come on, there's a blessing in this house. I don't know what you've come to do.
We are His people. Somebody shout the name of Jesus. Hey!
Come on, don't stop praising him. Come on, don't stop praising him. Come on, everybody clap those hands in this house. Come on, is that your testimony tonight? Savior, don't pass me by. Yes. Come on, put those hands together. Come on. Hear my.
today is a special day. I'm telling you, I've got one of my heroes, one of my truly good friends. I tell you, Brother Haynie, we go back to when I arrived here. And, he loved me really probably before anybody else would love me or even, he kind of took me in and took care of me. And he'd take me and feed me. And I tell you, I love this man, and I'm so thankful you're here, brother. We'd love for you to come in and obey the Holy Ghost today, brother.
Yes, sir. Billy, it's a pleasure being here with you. It's an honor. And going back, we had some good memories.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Hallelujah.
It's been a blessing watching the hand of the Lord on your life and watch God prosper you. And man, the Holy Ghost is so sweet, so good.
Yes, sir.
I don't mean to get emotional right off the bat.
Ooh,
but,
hallelujah.
But God is good.
Yes, sir.
He is. And I would like to share, a little bit of my testimony. I'm first generation Pentecostal. So, I grew up in a preacher's home. My dad was a minister, Methodist minister, for a number of years in the Morrilton and Plumerville area. And he started his ministry when I was probably around eight years old. And so I grew up going to church and had a good mother. She worked, and my sister, she was 2 years younger than me, and we were a close family. My dad, he obviously pastored the church, but he was a good father. He had me involved in Boy Scouts and spent a lot of time with me. I've got a lot of good memories with my dad. And we were in a small town, so I was influenced by, some pretty rough kids at the time. I was, there was not many people for us to play with and to have a good time with, so we were limited. And these guys that I was hanging around with, they were my neighbors, so I kind of fell into a pretty rough crowd at a young age. We played sports most of the time. We were playing ball, playing baseball and football and just doing what kids do. But they had some bad habits at a young age that, I kind of picked up on. But they were all a lot older than me, so they had some influence on me. They were pretty tough on me because I was young, and they'd pick on me a little bit, and they toughened me up a little bit, pretty quick at a young age. But sports was a big thing for me, and it really connected me and my mother in a special way. She really enjoyed watching me play ball and seeing me do good. On the academic side, I had I was diagnosed ADD and ADHD, and had some learning disabilities there that was a struggle for me and my mom, because she was the one helping me with my homework. And come to find out, I didn't realize this until I was probably 35 years old, but I realized that I had dyslexia, severe dyslexia. And that was, that was something that nobody knew a lot about back, when I was 10, 12 years old. And the learning disability, they thought it was just an attention thing, but it was more severe than that. And I did good in school. I made passing grades, but, brother, it was a struggle. And there was friction between me and my mother because she just didn't have much patience, you know. And bless her heart, she didn't know what was going on. So anyway, but I really gleaned a lot of love from my mother through the sports. You know, she something I could really make her proud of, you know, because she loved watching me perform in the sports world. And I wasn't a major league baseball player or NFL football player or anything like that, but I did good. And through junior high and high school, I really got involved in football, and that just become my world. And, you know, for teenagers in public school and being involved in competitive sports, that's just the center of their life.
That's right.
And it meant a lot to me to perform and do well. And obviously because, you know, I enjoyed it, I loved it, but also it was a connection, you know, there with my mother. And when I guess I was around 15 years old, I started getting in a little trouble. Got my hardship license and started drinking a little beer and got pulled over and got a DUI and things started getting rocky. And my dad at that time had been pastoring for about 13 years. And as time went on, I kept getting in trouble and ended up, you know, my dad ended up resigning the church. And, you know, as a teenager, I was going through all those things with alcohol and getting in trouble. And I just kind of connected my dad stepping away from the church because of my reputation. You know, I was in the newspaper and everybody knew, you know, I was getting in trouble. So that's when I was 15, that's when life started really getting hard. And I was making it hard on myself. I just didn't know. I was just trying to deal with life the best way I knew how to deal with it. And my senior year of high school, I ended up hurting my knee, and I couldn't play the rest of the season out in football. And, brother, that just crushed me because football was my world, you know. And like I said, that's something that connected me and my mother in a special way. And so, you know, I was bitter. I was mad at God at that time. I remember I was upset because I felt like he took something from me that I loved and I was good at it, you know. So, you know, things really got bad after that because I really leaned into, you know, the other drugs and alcohol. And I don't want to spend a lot of time on that, but you know where that leads. You know, it leads to a real dark place and lost a lot of direction in life. And I was just wandering around from the time I graduated high school, which I graduated at 17, till I was 22 years old. And I can remember... I can remember the morning that the Lord dealt with me. And I don't like getting emotional, but it is what it is. Me and some friends were, you know, we've been out partying and doing drugs, and it was an ice storm that come through, and it froze everything over for good 10 days. It shut everything down. And of course we're out roaming around, and we was coming off of this mountaintop on a pavement road, and it overlooked the city. And I'm telling you, the Lord dealt with me. And I said, man, I gotta get out of here. I gotta change something, you know, this isn't working. And told my best friend, he was with me, and me and him grew up together, and I told him, I said, man, I'm getting out of here. I'm moving to North Little Rock. I had some grandparents there, and I said, man, I'm leaving right now. So we headed to the house, and I packed all my stuff up, and he was fighting mad. He couldn't believe I was going to leave him, you know. And I did. I left him, and so I moved to North Little Rock, and my mother eventually moved. She relocated, and my dad, he was working out of town, and he eventually come back to Sherwood, and him and I were working together, actually. He worked for Bill Lockridge in Sherwood, good friend of Brother Clifton, and he was selling mobile homes. And I worked for my dad, you know, I wanted to be a salesman. And I told my dad one day, I said, "Dad, you know, we ought to go by that church on the freeway." I said, "We ought to go try it out." You know, I didn't know anything about Pentecost. And he said that he would like to go try it out. And I said, "Well, what do they believe?" And he said, well, they're a little charismatic. You know, they speak in tongues and they clap their hands and they're a little charismatic. And I was like, "Well, man, that sounds fun to me. Let's go try it out." So we did. And in fact, my aunt came with us, and I believe it was around Easter. And we went and sat pretty close to the front, and Bishop Holmes was preaching, and man, I can't remember what he preached. I can't remember one thing he preached, but I can remember what I felt. And the Holy Ghost started doing the work. Yes, sir. And I can remember driving to I was driving to a girlfriend's house that afternoon. And when I was driving to her house, she lived about an hour away from North Little Rock. And I just started weeping and crying for no reason. And I'm sitting there talking to myself. I'm like, "Man, what are you crying for?" And it was the Holy Ghost, you know, working on me. And I got to her house, and I was so excited about telling her about this experience I had. And she was Baptist. Oh. Nothing against Baptists, but her daddy was the deacon of the church. Mm. And she told her mother that I went to that Pentecostal church, and it wasn't a day or two later, her mother called me and told me not to ever call again. Mm. And so I'm really thankful for that, but yes, but Lord. It didn't really break my heart. I just knew that there was something special that I felt, and there was something special that I experienced, you know. And anyway, I want to move on, and I remember going back to my dad, and my poor dad, he was backslid. He wasn't in church, and I said, "Dad, I want to go back to that church, First Pentecostal Church." And he said, "Well, why, you know, there's other churches around. Why don't we go visit this church?" And I said, "No, sir." I said, "I want to go back to that church." That's right. You know, and I did go back, and I met Tommy Jones. And Tommy Jones took me around and invited me and introduced me to everybody in the church. And I got to meet Elder Sister Holmes. And I'm going to get really emotional with this one now. So she was so special. Brother, she was an angel. And she took me in and started praying with me and my mother. My mother came. And my mother come for about a year. And she loved my mother. I always reached out to my mother. But I always prayed with Sister Holmes. I prayed with her about 2:00 every afternoon at the church. And she had a real big impact on my life. She was a special lady. And she actually prayed me through to the Holy Ghost. But she, I've heard that she prophesied one night, and she was saying that she had a vision that angels were being sent from the steeple of the church out into the freeway, into cars, and bringing people in. And that's what happened to me, Billy. I was driving down the freeway, and I saw that church. And I'm telling you, something compelled me to go and find out what was going on. And I enjoyed telling her that, you know, that she was prophesying about me. You know, one of them angels grabbed me and brought me in. And but she holds a special place in my heart. I've had many, many prayer meetings with her, and I miss her dearly. So she prayed me through to the Holy Ghost, and Tommy introduced me to my wife, Lori Beard at the time. And when I seen her for the first time, I knew she was the one. And so we started dating, and we were married about 2 years after that. And so, you know, God has blessed me, you know, spiritually and physically. I'm just so thankful for the Holmeses and their spirit of loving people, you know. And Bishop, you know, he treated me like I was his son, and mentored me through many situations. And Pastor Nathan, you know, of course, he has just been like a brother, a big brother, and he is a rock. He's someone that I can always count on. Yeah, Pastor Nathan. So when I received the Holy Ghost, and I was married to my beautiful wife, and we've got children. We started off with Vivianne, and then Aiden. And during this time, we were living with my in-laws. So I was working a job, making probably $13 an hour doing heat and air. And I was searching, trying to figure out what I was going to do to be able to provide a good living for my family. And I was trying to get on at the railroad and had a few interviews with them. And, of course, that would have carried me off. That wouldn't have been the right thing to do. But I got on, I've started a fast, and I told the Lord I would do bus ministry. And Brother Ed Culpepper was leading it up. And I went the first weekend I did bus ministry. I rode with Brother Ed and told Brother Ed that I was looking for a new job. And come find out L'Oreal was hiring. And he got me an interview at L'Oreal, and I was hired. And so the Lord worked that out real quick. And I was making decent money there at L'Oreal. It was, at the time, it was a lot. And the Lord blessed me to be able to buy a house in Park Hill. And I had a neighbor in Park Hill. His name was Chris Seaton, and he had just started his own heat and air company. And the reason why I knew this, he would have equipment, furnaces, and condensers out by the road, and I seen his HVAC number on the back of his truck. And one day I was coming in from church one Sunday afternoon, and he was standing outside painting some doors. And I said, well, I'm going to go talk to this guy. And I introduced myself, and come to find out, he was a good friend of one of my cousins that was killed in a four-wheeler accident. So we had a connection there immediately. And he asked me what I did, and I told him I had HVAC experience. And he said, well, man, I need a helper. Can you start tomorrow And he called me at 7 o'clock the next morning, and I was riding with him, working, doing HVAC during the day and working at Maybelline in the evenings. And I told Pastor about it, and Bishop, and he said, well, brother, why don't you just get your HVAC license? And when he said that, I automatically shut that down. I said, well, there's no way, you know, there's no way I could do that. But that's all it took. He planted that seed in my spirit. And come to find out, Chris, the guy I was doing the HVAC work for, had the material, the books. And they were highlighted and labeled for me to study to get my license. And he let me have them. And I went and put in an application to take my test and went and took it and passed it. And got my HVAC license. And I'm not one to like to work in one place, especially a factory. Right. And that Maybelline job was, brother, that was awful. And I got my license, and I was working with Chris, and it was spring, and people's air conditioners were breaking down, and people that knew me were calling me. And so I just took the plunge and went out on my own. And it wasn't long. I mean, within weeks, I got a contract with Sears Home Improvement. And, man, I started doing subcontract work for them, and it just took off. Lord blessed it. And I guess that was in 2008. So I've been in business since 2008, and I've got 20 employees and been running that thing ever since. And God's been blessing. I'm rejoicing in it today. That's the benefit of living for God and digging out a prayer life and letting God lead and direct us. And I'm thankful for it.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Brother Haynie, thank you. Hadn't y'all been blessed, I tell you. 2008, brother, that brings back memories. I got here June of 2008, brother. And I'm going to tell you, that was a good year. I tell you that Brother Haynie took me in. He'd take me in. I'd get to go ride with him, and he'd feed me. And then, I remember having appointments out there, and it'd be snowing, and didn't have no transportation, and you slap it in four-wheel drive, brother, take me to my appointments. And I'm telling you, brother, thank you so much, Brother Haynie, for that. And, man, we love you. Thank you so much. We're going to ask our pastor to come in and sing a song called Work.
You thought I was worth saving, so you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping, so you cleaned me up inside. You thought I was to die for, so you sacrificed your life, so I could be free, I could be whole.
I'm
So you sacrificed